Without further ado, I'm very excited to tell you about our first guest of the night. Sorry, I'm a little bit, it's been a busy day. I'm a little frazzled. So this is super interesting. This is Blake Scholl. Blake, you want to come over here?
Sure.
Thank you. Blake is the CEO of Boom, which is a Denver-based startup that's working on supersonic jets. No kidding. I think that's pretty amazing. Blake is a Carnegie Mellon grad who spent a handful of years at Amazon becoming sort of a mobile shopping guru before founding his own company or co-founding a company called Kima Labs, selling that to Groupon, staying at Groupon for a couple of years, and then deciding that he really wanted to pursue his passion, which is Boom. So we're going to sit down here, but there's so much to tell you about with regard to this company that I thought I would just kind of get you all up to speed really quickly, and then we're going to dive into the interview. So first, for those of you who don't know, Boom was founded in 2014. Blake has told me that it's fast approaching 150 employees, and they come from NASA, Airbus, Lockheed Martin, SpaceX. The company is setting out to build supersonic jets that can fly at twice the speed of sound, which is 2.5 times faster than airplanes fly today. These are going to be business class airliners that have 55 seats and flown on transatlantic flights, like New York to London, San Francisco to Tokyo, Seattle to Shanghai. This is partly because of the sonic boom, which is so loud that a lot of countries have banned these types of planes from flying overhead. Boom has also raised $141 million in funding already, including from Japan Airlines, Emerson Collective, and Y Combinator. And it's using the capital it has raised so far to develop a two-seat aircraft that it hopes will be completed this year and will sort of prove out the bigger plane, which is called the Overture, the 55-seater plane. And what's interesting to note here is that Boom is not a new airline, but it's a creator of aircraft. So you've got already some pre-orders from Virgin Atlantic and another company, I believe.
Japan Airlines, yes.
Japan, okay. So great. So I know a lot of information, but there's, again, like I said, a lot to know about this company. So Blake, you know, I know you're sort of new to this audience, especially flying in just a minute ago from Denver. Thank you very much for doing
that.
So you're at Groupon. You don't have an aerospace background, but you decide that you are the guy to start a supersonic jet company. How did that happen? Why did you decide to pursue this?
Well, confluence of a couple things. I think back to the decision I made to sell the first company. And, you know, we'd gone through a couple pivots. We were going to raise another round. It was clear that, like, you know, all startups are going to be hard and there are going to be some rough times ahead. And so we had a very attractive offer from Groupon. And I thought, is it worth what I will go through personally for the product we're building? Or should I take the great offer and live to found another day? And so I took the offer. And in reflecting on that, what I realized is, like, all startups are hard. There's no such thing as an easy startup. And what often makes the difference is what decisions you make in those moments. What happens when you get up in the morning and it's a rough day? Do you think, why did I get into this thing? Or do you think, it doesn't matter, it's totally worth it? And so after leaving Groupon, I had a whole bunch of startup ideas, everything from rental cars to some stuff in healthcare. And my personal passion for a long time had been airplanes. And so when I put on that lens of how happy will I be personally if it works, anything with an airplane in it would float to the top of the list. And so I thought, well, I got to look at this supersonic thing that I've been sort of thinking about for a decade and do some research and probably get it out of my system.
So I guess, how do you start to put together a plan to create a jet that flies at, you know, twice the speed of sound?
Well, the first thing was to understand why it hadn't been done already. And it turns out there was a bunch of just false conventional wisdom. You know, the space it's capitally intensive, it's highly regulated. There are only two companies on the planet that build long-range commercial aircraft. So it just scares off a lot of entrepreneurs. And if you Google, why don't planes go faster, you find a bunch of things that sound reasonable. Mm-hmm. And so the thing that really worked was say, well, let's just start with first principles and say, hey, Concorde existed. Like, this was done 50 years ago with, you know, slide rules and wind tunnels. Half a century later, like, well, why is that not working and what would it take? And the answer was that the fuel economy was the problem. That was the fundamental problem. It was too expensive to operate. Not enough people could afford to fly on it. And you start to run the numbers and you say, well, by the way, all this stuff you can do out of Wikipedia. Concorde was too inefficient. How much better than Concorde would you have to do to make this economically feasible? It turns out the answer is 30%. versus what was designed, again, a long time ago. And you start to realize that, and you say, well, that doesn't sound impossible. You start to, I went off and read some aerospace textbooks and took a design class and started to meet everybody I could find in the industry and told them to shoot holes in my idea. And eventually people started to say, no, this actually makes sense. And then so we started the company.
So how much of what you're working on is built from scratch versus building on the work of your predecessors?
Yeah, we're really standing on the shoulders of all the work that's happened in aerospace since, literally since Concorde 50 years ago. And we've gone from aluminum as the material to carbon fiber composites. We've gone from defining aerodynamics in wind tunnels to be able to do it in simulation through cloud computing. We've gone from engines that are loud and very inefficient to modern jet engines that are quiet and sip fuel. And it turns out, like, if you take all that technology that's been proven, the big players in the space have been sort of iteratively optimizing the same airplanes we've had since the 1960s. But you can actually take that same technology and deploy it, instead of making the machine more efficient, make the human more efficient, and deploy it in service of speed. So the design of our airplane is very radical. But the fundamental technology is conventional.
I think we have a picture of it, if we could show it. John, can you get the picture of the plane up here? Thank you. Oh, sorry. So obviously the wings are sort of in the back.
Mm-hmm.
And how many jet engines?
It's got three. So one under each wing and a third one in the tail.
Okay. And who's building the jet engines?
So we haven't picked a provider yet, but we're working with two of the three major jet engine companies who are basically bidding to provide a custom engine for us.
Okay. And I guess, why did you decide on this size? Obviously, this is not your prototype. This is sort of the
full size. That's the first full size.
Okay.
Yes. So again, if you look at it relative to Concorde and you say, well, it's not enough just to do something really cool. You have to make the economics work. And so what you need to do is make the machine efficient enough that more people can afford to fly on it. You got to get the fares down. And then the second thing you got to do is right-size the airplane so that if you're in the airline business, you live and die by something called load factor, which is the percentage of seats that are filled.
Right.
And if you put too many seats on the airplane relative to the price of those seats, you fly around empty and it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. So at 55 seats, one way to think of that is we took a Boeing or Airbus wide body and we chopped off the business class cabin, the front cabin, which is like 10% of seats, and we made it go really fast. What that means is if you're an airline and you fly a wide body on a route and you can fill the seats and make money, well, you could do the same thing with Overture. At the same price point, you can make the same or better money charging business class fares, and you can fill the seats on hundreds of routes.
So the objective ultimately is to accommodate many more people. But for this, my understanding was the Concorde, for example, was the cabin was actually quite small and not necessarily very comfortable. I'm sure this is sort of very much like a later consideration, but have you put much thought into how the cabin will look and
oh, of course.
Will it have to be very narrow?
The very first thing we built in my co-founder's garage was a mock-up of the cabin. Because it is size sensitive, and you want to understand, what's the back of the airplane going to be like? You got to make sure it's still going to be a good flight. Because if it's a 3 or 4 hour flight instead of a 7, 8, 9 hour flight, you're still on there long enough that comfort matters.
Right.
And so you can put... you can put a really nice interior in the airplane. So it'll be sort of business class style, a nice wide seat, big windows, plenty of room to work or relax. But when the flight is 3 or 4 hours, the seat doesn't have to lay flat the way it does in business class today. By the time you get it down, it's time to put it back up.
Right. Okay, so you said you're still trying to decide on a sort of a jet engine provider. But again, this is highly ambitious. Are there any other partnerships that you struck, maybe with mm-hmm. Japan Airlines, or
yeah.
how are you sort of...
So if you think about this from a... how do you make this work as a startup? Because on the face of it, it sounds like something that only big companies can do. I think of Boom as... it's like got four ingredients to make it successful. Number one is the engineering execution mm-hmm. on the airplane. So that's the one thing we control directly. Number two is the customer demand. So you're showing that you're building not just something that seems cool, but something that airlines really want. Number three is the supplier partnerships. So folks that will build jet engines, folks that do carbon fiber composites, folks that do avionics. Unless you're going to build the whole thing soup to nuts yourself, you need those partnerships. And then last but not least, you need a lot of capital. And so I think of, and each of those components kind of wants the rest. Like the investors want to know the airlines are there. The airlines always ask what the engine companies ask who the airlines are. And so it's like a four-way chicken and egg problem. And I often tell the team we're in the chicken omelet business. And so what you do is incrementally spiral up. And so the tech on the airplane, this is counterintuitive for people. The tech is actually conventional stuff that's flying on other airplanes today, proven safe and reliable and efficient. But the way you go to market and the way you build partnerships is completely different. from the way a Boeing or Airbus would do it. So we call it dating engagement marriage. And so you start off with whether it's a airline partnership or whether it's a supplier partnership, you start off with something relatively loose, like a letter of intent. That allows you to go off and show credibility to other parties, and you come back and you progressively sharpen those things. So where we stand today on the airline side, if we pre-sold 30 airplanes, and at $200 million.
What does that mean when you say pre-sold? That means it's letter of intent, essentially.
It's a bit more than a letter of intent. This is part of the like go-to-market engineering that turns out to matter. So it's basically an option agreement with some like cleverly engineered terms, which I can't go into too much, but basically we achieve some milestones on our first prototype over the next year, and that kicks the options into expiration. Okay. And so the airlines at the maximum point of boom being credible have to place a firm order or lose a bunch of favorable things.
Smart. Okay, so this prototype is going to be done by the end of 2019.
Yeah, we're building it now.
I'm sure another consideration, which I think you mentioned fleetingly, is financing. You've raised $144 million-ish.
Yes.
So how much more do you need to raise, including just to finish? Is that enough to finish the prototype?
Yeah, the company is very well funded right now. So we have all the money we need to go make history. Now, to go into full commercialization is a lot more capital. Mm-hmm. So the total development cost is going to be on the order of $6 billion. But the trick is to do it as much as possible non-dilutively. So out of the six, you can do five out of six, either supplier financing, customer prepayments, debt, and you end up needing to raise about $1 billion in equity. Okay. So it's a large number, but that's an obtainable number.
Okay. I just know because there's some airline investors here who might want to take a look. I think what you're doing is so interesting, but what I think is also interesting is you're not the only company doing this. Boeing just teamed up with a company, Arion, I guess it announced this in February, that's developing a jet that's going to fly at 1,000 miles per hour. Mm-hmm. And just yesterday, I'm sure you saw this, there's an Atlanta-based company called Hermes, I think, that just raised an undisclosed amount of seed funding, and it wants to fly five times the speed of sound. Mm-hmm. So many things to ask here, but I guess how did you settle on 2.5 times the speed of sound when, you know, these others are sort of picking other ends of the spectrum?
So you want to be on the happy side of enough market opportunity, and you want to be on the happy side of a lot of technology challenge. And so we're Mach 2.2 times the speed of sound. And at that speed, you can use well-established materials, well-established engines. There are great solutions for how you make the airplane quiet around airports, which is really important. And when you go to the FAA and you say, here's the technology package on my airplane, do you know how to approve it? They say, yes, we've done that before. Mm-hmm. If you go much slower, it does get easier, but then the passenger value prop starts to fall away. So think of New York to London. Mm-hmm. Today, you fly that as a red eye. It's like 7 hours. And if you take that 7-hour flight and you make it 6 or 5 hours, you're probably still flying it overnight, but now it's a pink eye. You almost wish the flight were longer and you could sleep more. Mm-hmm. But at Mach 2.2, the red eye flight turns into a daytime flight. So you leave New York in the morning and you get to London Heathrow in time to make an afternoon meeting. You can be back in time to tuck your kids into bed. So it turns a red eye flight into a daytime flight. At Mach numbers less than 2.0, that story doesn't work.
I'm also just interested, do they all fly at different flight heights? So you're flying at like 60,000 feet, is that correct?
Yes.
So what would you imagine a Mach 5 flight would...
The rule of thumb is the faster you fly, the higher you fly.
Yeah.
There's a trade-off between what happens with wind resistance and how efficient the engines are, mm-hmm. and the net of it is the faster your speed, the higher you are.
You also talked about fuel efficiency. I'm just wondering, is there anything else going on now, or is it just, you know, people love fast things, they love flying objects, there's tons of capital out there, so that kind of equals opportunity? Or is there a tech piece that wasn't possible before, beyond, you know, better fuel consumption?
Yeah.
And maybe lighter materials.
There's some stuff that's tech, like I would call out two things that are recent. You're going from aluminum to carbon fiber, which Boeing really pioneered on the 787, and going from wind tunnels to software simulation. That levels the playing field for what a startup can do. Mm-hmm. But the other thing that people overlook is globalization. You know, since Concorde retired in 2003, international travel has grown by a factor of 2.5. So the world is more connected than it's ever been, and the need to be there in person is greater than it ever has been. So the market, what we have now is an intersection between market and technology that didn't exist all that long ago.
So I guess, you know, how big is the market? I mean, when you can talk about how big the international, you know, mm-hmm. marketplace is, but you are initially going to be targeting a certain type of customer who can afford a business class or higher price ticket. Is that correct?
That's right. I mean, the long-range vision is to make the fastest flight the cheapest one at all classes of fares. And there is a very straightforward way you can make that happen within our lifetimes. But you have to pick the right starting point. We believe the right starting point is business class. So that's, think 5,000 round trip New York to London would be very profitable. And you could do that, 3 hours and 15 minutes each way.
You would be very profitable.
Oh yeah.
Are you using like special fuel, or I mean, is it? What have you figured out that the airlines haven't figured out?
There's no silver bullet in this. It's a whole bunch of lead bullets, or actually carbon bullets. So you make the aerodynamics a little bit more efficient. Like if you look at the airplane carefully, the back of the airplane is a little bit skinnier than the front of the airplane. That's something called area ruling, which they knew about in Concorde's time, but building that out of aluminum was really hard. It was basically economically infeasible. But in carbon fiber composites, you mold the whole airplane. You can make any shape you want. So you can do these really dynamic shapes that are more optimized. So there's aerodynamics. There's the materials being lighter that enable those aerodynamics. There's the engines being more efficient. There's Concorde famously had that iconic droop nose. And, people think it was there for aerodynamic reasons. The actual answer was the nose was long and the pilots couldn't see over it to land. And so they had to lower the nose for runway visibility. But today we've got this amazing thing called a camera and a retina display.
Right.
And you can make it like the nose of the airplane is just transparent. And so all those things add up to little bits of efficiency or weight savings. And that, and then on top of that, you get something that we call the speed dividend. So when you go faster, the hard thing technically is to make the fuel efficiency good. Mm-hmm. But if you make all the other costs are proportional to hours, like the rent on the airplane, the crew, the catering, it's all how long is the flight. And if you make the flight shorter, all those costs come down. And if you make it enough shorter, people who would otherwise want lay flat beds are going to be fine with regular size seats instead. And all those add up to faster flights actually being less expensive to operate. Mm-hmm.
That's very interesting. But eventually, again, you want to accommodate more people.
Mm-hmm.
So is this plane just gets bigger? I mean, what happens when you do start accommodating mm-hmm. more people? You lose all of those advantages that you just talked about.
Actually, they get better.
Okay.
So here's how it works. So if you look back at last time we had a speed up, late 1950s, early 1960s, when we went from props into the jet age, the flights got faster by about the same factor we're talking about here. It was like a 2 or 3x speed up. But people didn't spend less time on airplanes, they spent more. It was more worth going. So for example, San Francisco to Hawaii used to be 16 hours on a flying boat. When you hear that, you're like, let's go to Napa. But the whole Hawaii tourism industry exists because of the jet.
Mm-hmm.
And you see that wherever you look. When you break the time barrier, which is what matters, not the sound barrier. When you break the time barrier, people go more places more often. This airplane is sized around business class demand as it exists today, because that's what you can sell to airlines. But if the same thing happens again, and I believe deeply it will, more people are going to go more places more often. Like if you've got business in Singapore, how often do you go? If the flight's 16 hours, how often do you go if it's 8? It gets better when you travel more when flights are shorter. So 55 seats is going to turn out to be too small.
Sure, no, I understand the whole chicken and egg thing, and that if you have more people wanting to fly, but I just want to make sure that this is going to be safe when you, supersize it.
Oh, it actually gets better. Larger airplanes, both the safety and the economics get better. You can amortize two pilots across more passengers. It gets more efficient. The larger airplane can have lower fares because of that, which means more people can afford to go more places more of the time, and then you get this virtuous cycle spinning where ultimately you're able to make a larger airplane with enough demand in it that the fares can actually be like economy fares today.
But these would still be transatlantic flights for now. You said that there's new technology that can dampen that loud sound caused by the airwaves.
Well, there's a lot of mythology around sonic boom. In fact, there's a great Mythbusters episode on can you break a window with a sonic boom? It turns out the answer is yes, but you have to fly supersonic 50 feet over the ground and put the boom right in the middle of the window, which if you do that with a commercial flight, you got a bigger problem than a broken window. So I think the sonic boom thing is overblown. When you're up at 60,000 feet, you can hear it, but it's not gonna cause any real problems. And there's some things you can do technically that help it as well. But I think in a world where you can get from San Francisco to Tokyo, especially you can get from San Francisco to Washington, D.C., the rules that prevent supersonic flight over land are going to go away very quickly.
Well, you know, I mean, what's interesting about what you're doing is sort of all the sort of second order effects that could come from it, good and bad. And in fact, I'd first learned about Boom from this really, well, amazing woman who spoke at an event last year, and many of you know her, Katarina Fake, who is a VC and the co-founder of Flickr. She also now has a podcast called Should This Exist? And it looks at new technologies like Boom, and it sort of looks at what's great about them and where they could potentially become very dangerous. So I just wonder, I mean, you've got a lot to juggle as it is, but do you think about, you know, one thing, she, you know, the people that she interviewed talked about was how fast disease can spread if this sort of vision comes to fruition. Mm-hmm. The sort of climate externalities, I mean, you're saying it's more fuel efficient, but it's still, you know, there's, you know, carbon emissions. I'm just wondering how much time you've sort of...
A ton.
Yeah.
I mean, we wouldn't have backing from Emerson if we weren't all over this stuff.
Right.
And the, you know, the I think the interesting thing on the environmental impact of supersonic is most people are very, very focused on the carbon emissions on a kind of per flight basis. Mm-hmm. And you know, we're going to be at parity with subsonic business class out of the gate on that, so it's no problem. But what's interesting is if you look at the second order effects, mm-hmm. if you make flights faster, there's going to be more travel. And I think that's where the really interesting environmental question comes up. Like, what happens when there's six times the visitors to, you know, Fiji, because all of a sudden you can get there more easily? I think
that's maybe not so great for Fiji.
Well, it could be, but you have to plan for it and prepare for it. What happens when there's six times more people going to SFO? You know, it's already pretty crowded.
Right.
So I think there's, you know, I see our role is we have to get out there and tell that story, and we have to be the advocates of, you know, scaling tourism and travel in a very responsible way so that we can, when we make the planet more accessible, it's a good thing, not a bad thing. Mm-hmm.
I guess more immediately, Airbus's reputation has obviously taken a terrible hit with these fatal crashes.
But Boeing, right?
Boeing, yes, I'm sorry. So tell me a little bit about how you test your planes. I mean, obviously you're only testing a prototype, which is not completely developed yet. So how can you sort of make people feel comfortable that...
It's an extremely complex machine. You know, what we're building will probably be one of the most complex safety critical machines ever built by humanity. And so the way you do that safely is you stand on the shoulders of what's been done before. And you know, we're watching the lessons that come out of the you know, the recent incidents with the 737 for what we can learn from it. And if you look at the regulations that exist today, it's often said in the industry they're written in blood. So every single rule came from, well, this went wrong when one point, don't do it that way anymore. Mm-hmm. And so it requires a high level of diligence, a high level of attention to detail. You have to have the right organizational structure. We have checks and balances in the team. And you have to have a culture where anybody can feel comfortable speaking up when they see a problem. You know, one of the ways this goes wrong is no one speaks up about a problem when it's obvious because they think everyone sees it. And I look at the stuff that happened recently. The problems seem really obvious. Probably that a culture where everyone thought it was obvious and no one spoke up. I mean, that's speculation on my part, but this is things we think about day to day in Boom and say, if you see a problem and the more obvious it is, the more important you speak up about it. And you just have incredible diligence and a great team. There's no silver bullet. It's really hard work.
But on a very practical level, it's like there's a wind tunnel in Denver. How are you sort of?
Yeah, so you validate basically each component individually. So that, you know, the same way in the software world where you do unit tests, then functional tests, and integration tests, conceptually it's very similar. So the first thing you do for materials is you get little samples of materials and you test them at extreme temperatures and you see exactly what they do. Then you test joints and then you test substructures. And then you test a whole wing and you kind of build up to the whole airplane, knowing all the components do what you think they will do. And with aerodynamics, the same thing. You go run software simulations, then you go to a real wind tunnel and you validate that real air does what the simulated air does. You run the engines in a test cell and you characterize their performance. And then when you get into the flight test program, you do something called envelope expansion, which is basically you start off, I'll contrast this with rockets. Rockets are famous for blowing up. And that's because you light the candle and either it goes to space or it doesn't. Mm-hmm. But airplanes, you know, you can take off and you can land and you can see how that was. And then you can take off and go a little bit faster and try turning and then land. And so you gradually expand the capabilities of the airplane and you're taking data constantly. There'll be a room of like 50 people on the ground watching real-time telemetry data when you do flight tests. And you stop if something doesn't look like you expect it to and you proceed when it does.
So your test pilots are not going to be going at Mach 2 immediately.
Not immediately, but you know that's another thing is you get great test pilots. So you know our chief test pilot did the first flight in the F-18 Super Hornet, and was Larry Page's chief test pilot at Zero, and you know those folks know what they're doing. They're betting their life that you got it right, and the right ones get involved in the engineering and they check all the math themselves.
I think we're almost out of time, but I did want to ask, too, just about the FAA. I don't follow the industry closely enough to know if they've, you know, reacted in a sort of permanent way to what happened with these fatal crashes, or if you're sort of finding yourself in closer communication with them suddenly than you might have been, you know, 6 months ago.
Nothing's changed super recently with that. We've been working with the FAA very closely for several years now. And you know, we view FAA as our partners in helping us build a safe airplane. And it's a very collaborative relationship. It's a very good relationship. The folks at the FAA are very excited about what we're doing. And I'm sure they'll have some learnings out of what's happened. And I can't wait to find out about them and make sure that we benefit from them.
And Blake, I don't know if you're willing to talk about a timeline, but when are we going to see this?
We're doing it as fast as we can, but we're not skipping any of the safety testing steps. So we'll have that for. first prototype will be, you know, roll out this year. It'll be flying less than a year from now, and then it's about 6 years from demonstrating flight in the prototype airplane to being safe to carry passengers. So our target's 2025.
Great, 6 years. Well, thank you so much, Blake. Super interesting, and I would love to hear more, you know, in the future.
Thanks so much, Ben.
Thank you so much. Thanks, guys.